I'm Arno Hartwald. I head up the integrated R&D group at ICT. Co-authors are Adam Riley at FAST and Sharon Mosguy. And we were approached by the Smithsonian to leverage our expertise in virtual humans to help design and develop an application that allows educators to create educational videos from the classroom. And we called it Application Canvas, and this talk is about the design and development of Canvas. Now, one of the challenges in teaching, in particular teaching STEM, which stands for science, technology, engineering, and math, is how to do it effectively. How do you engage students, and how do you not increase the burden on educators? This is a challenge in general, and especially if we have our kids in front of a Zoom screen the entire day. So our approach to that was create a tool that allows educators to rapidly create educational, engaging videos for use in the classroom to introduce a new topic, to discuss anything that is relevant in the news within STEM, and we call that Canvas. Now, Canvas is a mix of machinima and intelligent virtual agents. It generates a first pass of nonverbal behavior that allows an author to manually polish the content generated. And this has been funded by the Smithsonian Science Education Center. In terms of related work, Machinima stands for Machine Cinema. It's often used originally with video games and the tools and assets that they provide. One of the early ones was Stunt Island that was released by Disney in 1992. And the original intent was for gamers to create their own stunts with airplanes and with cars, make video and show that to their friends. As you can see here, though, they quickly took that and created very elaborate stories. Now, that followed in other computer games like Doom and Quake, just using these characters, create video clips, build larger stories out of it. Gary's Mod was very popular, taking some of Valve's assets like Counter-Strike and Half-Life 2 in order to create whatever you want. And then it hit the mainstream with South Park and World of Warcraft.
World of Warcraft, I need to play!
Our demo was set up right over by the...
Got to sign in. Character name. All right, I'm in.
Dude, I'm almost dead.
Kyle, cast arcane missiles.
I'm out of mana, I told you. I've got to heal.
Stan!
Dad, not now!
Stan, I've been sent here to bring you this. This sword can completely drain his mana.
Dad, how did you get that?
No time. Just take it. Here.
How do you hand something from one player to another?
Bring up your inventory screen. Control I.
Okay.
On a slightly more scientific angle, a lot of effort has gone into interactive storytelling, generation of stories, etc. This is work by Elson and Mark Rydell, a system called CanBot, taking an existing story and coming up with a cinematography for it. You can see different shot lists generated on the left and the right based on different heuristics. Stories can be generated as well from the get-go, often using task models where preconditions and effects are used to look at how can certain actions either thwart or help an antagonist or a protagonist. And the system authors used this here to create a system called Suspenser that allowed them to look at the suspense being generated for a viewer or a reader. Now that brings us closer to work we've done a lot here in the IVA community, nonverbal behavior generation. I'm assuming most of you are familiar with FML and BML, creating a communicative intent, using that to create a behavior plan, and then having a behavior realization system executing that plan. In terms of work being done on the generation and realization side, it's a who's who of IVA. On the realization side, Beat, Cerebella, Greta, and MVBG. On the generation side, examples include ASAP, Greta, Relational Agents, and SmartBuddy. Now, in terms of Canvas itself, it's based on the Virtual Human Toolkit. We use a mix of components that are part of the toolkit and external to it. We use Cerebella to generate the nonverbal behavior, SmartBuddy to realize it, and the game engine Unity is tying all of that together. In terms of features, we have Ada, our virtual human. Now, the end result of Canvas is movie, so non-interactive. But Ava has been set up as a virtual human like other characters, in particular in order to support nonverbal behavior generation. So we do that based on script and audio. Authors can go in and polish and enhance that content. And they can use a lot of the content that we ship with Canvas, including environments, different outfits, animations, sound effects, and they can add to that custom images and videos so they can tackle any topic. We used a user-centered design process, and we identified two target audiences. The first one, kids. What is the kind of content that we want to create for them? And then educators or authors. How are we allowing them to create that type of content? Starting with the what, the type of content, this is the Ada character. This is the character we got from the Smithsonian. We adapted it somewhat, made it part of a pipeline, and we created different versions and outfits so we could target a larger range of topics, starting with space. Then we created several mockups. How do we want Ada to interact with custom images? Are we embedding them? What happens when we try to embed them in a picture of Mars? Maybe we should make it a frame. Or what happens if we do different lighting effects or we create a more appropriate themed border? What happens if we add Matt Damon to really drive home the point that we are on Mars? What happens if we look at Mars from the outside? So we could look at different ways that Ada can interact with images in the background. Does the position change, the size? Do we want different kinds of borders? How do we interact with any kind of custom topic? Now, that ultimately led to a style guide, in particular the personality of Ada as well. We want her to be enthusiastic. We want her to be science focused. We want her to be smart and really lead kids down in appreciation of STEM topics. All of that led to a first movie that highlights the personality and the style that we're going with. And this has been written, directed, and voiced by Grace Benn.
Hey, come on! Join the fun! Let me show you some of the seriously amazing things at the Smithsonian Institute. It has places like the National Air and Space Museum, where you can check out the Apollo 11 Command Module Columbia, or you can explore the universe at the Albert Einstein Planetarium. There's even a moon rock you can touch. And you don't even have to come here to see cool stuff. You can go to our website, si.edu. It's filled with videos, games, or my personal favorite, the Panda Cam. We're talking seriously amazing cuteness. So come on, let's explore.
So this was created by our own in-house tools in Unity directly, and it formed a target that we wanted to hit with the final tools. One of the things from a content point of view we noticed, though, if Ada is constantly in front of a screen, that's not that engaging. So we were brainstorming about ways to create a more engaging environment that's also very versatile. And after some thinking, we came up with a treehouse because everybody likes treehouses. We have amazing artists at ICT, and they made a lot of sketches in what a treehouse could look like. What are the different areas? We call those stations that we want to design where Ada can be. And we focused those on supporting the scientific process. So we added a library and a study nook and a lab and a newsroom. All of that iteratively fleshing it out, designing it, allowing us to finally create these designs in the Unity game engine. And you see several examples of that here. A newsroom on the left, the possibility space with the telescope on the right. Every space has different camera angles. Ada has different outfits. So it's a versatile environment in order to tell a story. Now, once we had that down, it's about how do we make that content? We start with generating nonverbal behavior. We use Cerebella for that. It allows us to semantically, syntactically, and acoustically process an input script and associated audio. Looking at the stress on words, looking at the amount of stress level overall for what the character is saying, and with a rule-based generation system that infers an ever more completed version of a communicative intent, come up with a behavior plan. The behavior plan is realized by SmartBuddy. It's fairly abstract originally and then gets instantiated for a specific character, allowing us to pull in specific animations, using co-articulation to really go into depth in terms of the boundaries of what the system is providing and generating that in real time. This was headed up by Stacy Marcella together with Stefan Shearer, Ari Shapiro, and others. I'm going to show you an initial movie they created to generate content.
You snotty little bastard.
Your Honor, I'd like to ask for a recess.
I'd like an answer to the question, Judge.
The court will wait for an answer.
If Lieutenant Kendrick gave an order that Santiago wasn't to be touched, then why did he have to be transferred? Colonel, Lieutenant Kendrick ordered the code red, didn't he? Because that's what you told Lieutenant Kendrick to do.
Object! And when it went bad, you cut these guys loose!
Your Honor,
you have Marcus inside a bony transfer.
Your Honor,
you doctored the logbook.
Damn,
you coerced the doctor.
Consider yourself in contempt.
Colonel Jessup, did you order the code red?
You don't have to answer that question.
I'll answer the question. You want answers?
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
Okay, after a generation passed, we want authors to go in and tweak that content. And this is one of our last wireframes that we created. You can see here the main video that authors are working on. Then a bar of different types of content, from scripts, animations, and camera angles, et cetera. A list of content within those asset categories and a preview of them. You can drag these to a timeline. These are all tracks that are organized by the type of content, and you can click on any elements of it to see a more detailed overview. And this is what that looks like finally implemented. So what I'm gonna do now is show a quick demo of that off Canvas. We created Canvas in Unity. So everything that's user facing is made in Unity. And then in the background, it communicates with other modules like Cerebella for the generation of the gestures, and nonverbal behavior and FFmpeg to create the actual movies. I'm gonna open a movie we made here. This is a version of the PandaCam movie that you saw earlier. That was our target movie, and we recreated this basically in this tool. So partly to validate that we could do it, partly to show an example of how to create the content, but also to look into the improvements that we had made in the meantime. Ada has more outfits, more animations. We can do more with the content in the back, including now adding videos. It really adds to help make engaging content.
Rock you can touch. And you don't even have to come here to see cool stuff. You can go to our website, si.edu. It's filled with videos, games, or my personal favorite, the PandaCam. We're talking seriously amazing cuteness. So come on, let's explore.
Now, if you want to create a new project, you can choose between the screen backgrounds or the treehouse. You can pick any of the outfits that we have, and you can point towards project-specific folders that may already have content that you created, like the script or custom videos or whatnot. But I'm pulling in all the content that comes with Canvas. You see here the categories of content that you can choose from, including images, videos, audio files, things like that. You can see a little preview here. I can drag this in or double click, add it here in the timeline at the appropriate type and generate nonverbal behavior. You can preview this. You can generate as many takes as you want until you have something that you like and then just take a look at it.
The seriously amazing things at the Smithsonian Institute.
So I kind of like that. I did not like this beat. Everything here is grouped because we generate everything, and it means you can move everything around. But I can change that group. I can add a new animation. If you can see, there's many, many animations, but you can filter them here. There's a twist animation, you can see the preview here, that really nailed down sort of the look and feel of her behavior. I can move these a little bit out of the way. The beginning could use a little bit of animation, so I'm gonna add that here. And then let's see, I'm gonna make a camera shot. So we're here at the work stage, I'm gonna make a tighter camera shot when she starts talking midway. And then I'm going to go to the possibility space. I'm going to move the camera to a new station. I'm going to add another track by double clicking so that I can also put the character position in the same space. I want her to talk about lions. And generate some behavior for that. And I want to show a movie once she is done with that here. You can put it on a monitor if it's in the environment, but I'm going to play it full screen through the telescope. And let's see what that looks like.
Hey, come on. Hey, come on.
It shows you, okay. I'm going to start that over. And let's see what that looks like.
Hey, come on! Join the fun! Let me show you some of the seriously amazing things at the Smithsonian Institute. Where can I go to see lions?
Okay, well, you got a good sense of the possibilities there. So let's go back. We learned a lot during this project. It was a very fun project to work on. In particular, putting down a process for the design and development, it's important to identify all of your end users very explicitly and all of their requirements, dependencies, and priorities. That allows you to tackle each of them and define clear targets, not only technically, but also creatively, as well as the boundaries for both. That allows you to create targets, it allows you to validate the tools with those targets. We did that with the initial movie. And ultimately, that allows you to end up with an iterative process with all the stakeholders focusing on creative, technical, and usability goals. So we deliver this to the Smithsonian. We are not funded for a next phase, but if that will happen, we would love to do an actual study with kids and educators, focus on improving the automation and generation capabilities, add more content for the feedback, and expand the platform support. It would be great to walk around in the treehouse in VR. And with that, we reached the end of this talk. This was a group effort. We worked with many people at ICT and the Smithsonian to make this a success. I want to thank all of them and thank you for your attention.